Hi, let's talk about autonomics. In this video, we'll describe the basic divisions of the autonomic nervous system and how they're structured. The autonomic nervous system is the automatic nervous system. It controls a variety of tissues with unconscious precision. So these are things that we don't think about, that we don't want to think about. So our rate of respiration, our heart rate, the rate at which we metabolize or produce glucose, whether our pupils are dilating or constricting, etc. So there are two divisions to the autonomic nervous system. There is the sympathetic division and the parasympathetic division. Most of the viscera and target tissues of the body are antagonistically innervated, meaning they're innervated by both the sympathetic division and the parasympathetic division, and they will have opposite effects on that target tissue or organ. So let's start with the parasympathetic division. The parasympathetic division is usually referred to as the division of rest and digest. It's also labeled as the craniosacral output. So with craniosacral, what is meant is that the various preganglionic fibers either come from the cranium in the form of one of four cranial nerves: the oculomotor nerve, cranial nerve 3, the facial nerve, cranial nerve 7, the glossopharyngeal nerve, cranial nerve 9, or the vagus nerve, cranial nerve 10. Most of these are going to serve various preganglionic parasympathetic fibers to head ganglia. So for instance, the oculomotor nerve 3 serves preganglionic fibers to the ciliary ganglion. That's a ganglion that hangs out just under the optic nerve, and it is going to serve the eye, specifically the sphincter pupillae muscles of the eye. Cranial nerve 7 serves two different ganglia. So there's the submandibular ganglion. Submandibular ganglion serves the submandibular and sublingual salivary glands. It also serves the pterygopalatine ganglion. Pterygopalatine ganglion is going to serve the lacrimal gland, so to produce tears, or it's also going to serve the mucosa of the nasal cavity and paranasal sinuses. Cranial nerve 9 provides the preganglionic parasympathetic fibers to the otic ganglion, that is a parasympathetic ganglion within the infratemporal fossa that is going to supply the innervation to the parotid gland, which is another of the salivary glands. And cranial nerve 10 leaves the head without supplying any parasympathetic ganglion, and the vagus is going to descend the neck in the carotid sheath, sending out branches to the pharynx and the larynx and various tissues of the neck. It's also going to provide autonomic innervation to the cardiac plexus, the pulmonary plexuses, the esophageal plexus, and then it's finally going down into the abdominal pelvic cavity, where it's going to parasympathetically serve the foregut and the midgut with innervation. Most of the postganglionic fibers of the head, interestingly enough, are going to hitchhike on another cranial nerve, the trigeminal nerve, cranial nerve number 5. The sacral output of craniosacral output are the pelvic splanchnic nerves. Pelvic splanchnic nerves are branches of the ventral primary rami of sacral nerves 2, 3, and 4. And these are going to provide the parasympathetic input to the inferior hypogastric plexuses of the pelvis, as well as the parasympathetic innervation to the hindgut. Now, the sympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system is referred to as the fight or flight. These are all of the responses that are going to get you ready to fight or flee for your life. It's organized by two sympathetic trunks that consists of ganglia that are held together by fibers that run the entire length of the spinal cord and beyond. Probably better said, the entire length of the vertebral column and beyond. So superiorly, all the way up from the superior cervical ganglion, adjacent to the basic cranium of the skull, all the way down to the ganglion impar of the coccyx, these sympathetic trunks run the length. Now the input to the sympathetic trunks comes from the thoracic and proximal lumbar spine. So whereas parasympathetics are the craniosacral outflow, sympathetics are the thoracolumbar outflow. And that's because the preganglionic sympathetic fibers travel from spinal nerves via white rami communicantes at levels T1 through L2. So that is the trunk input. Each sympathetic trunk or chain can then push fibers back to individual spinal nerves, and this occurs at every level of the spinal cord. It's important to note that fibers serving the head and neck are coming from the superior cervical ganglion via paravascular plexuses. There's also some contribution from the middle cervical ganglion if it's present. So we've discussed the parasympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system and its cranial nerve outflow, as well as sacral pelvic splanchnic nerve outflow, as well as the sympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system. This is your summary slide. I thank you for your time.